Welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining us. I'm Claire Donnelly, the health reporter at WFAE. This is WFAE Live, a series of conversations on topics important to the Charlotte area. Today is day three of our mental health series, where we're discussing mental health through a variety of lenses. If you missed the conversations from yesterday and Monday, you can see the recordings on the WFAE Facebook page, or you can go to wfae.org/mentalhealth. Welcome, everybody. Today, we're looking at alternative ways for mental health treatment, particularly music therapy, equine-assisted therapy, and therapeutic yoga. I will introduce our guests for today, Meg Stanley Johnson, the music therapy clinical coordinator at Queen's University of Charlotte, where she's also a senior instructor in the art, design, and music department. Katie Overcash is a licensed clinical social worker, registered yoga instructor, and neurofeedback practitioner at Overcash Therapy Services in Charlotte. Tia Tharp, executive director of Brightside Youth Ranch in York, South Carolina, which offers equine-assisted therapy for children and teens. Thank you all for being here. Welcome. So Meg, let's start with you. What is music therapy and what can it be used for?
Okay, that's kind of a big question. So I'll give you a big answer, and then I know as we go through the program, we'll kind of dig into it a little more. But in general, and specifically with mental health, a board-certified music therapist utilizes music in all different forms. And that's within a therapeutic relationship to help bring about change. So we work with the person individually to find out where their areas of need are, what change they are seeking, and then use music to help bring that change about. And that change can be about restoring functioning. It can be about building relationships. It can be about improving emotional response or emotional communication. It can be social, physiological, because music affects us in all of those ways. So,
yeah, I'm glad you mentioned it's such a broad category. It's not, you know, just sitting in a room and listening to music. It might be that, but it could also be, you know, learning to play an instrument, right? Could you give us some examples of what various music therapy sessions might look like?
Yeah, it's like I said, it's very individualized and really tunes into what that particular person needs or that particular group of people needs. So it can be receptive in terms of listening to music and using that either as for imagery and relaxation or to stimulate conversation. It can be expressive in terms of creating music and using it as an outlet for expressing emotion, releasing emotion, just identifying with the music, and then just the physiological release of that creation of music. It can be just improvisatory. It can be creative. We do a lot of songwriting and music therapy, helping use music to almost speak for the person, allowing the music to either through melody or words to help them more clearly express the feelings that maybe that they can't do on their own in a clear way.
I know it's a very individualized process, but are there certain methods that tend to work better for certain people struggling with certain things, or does it sort of vary widely?
Yeah, it really does vary very much for the individual person. Obviously, we can all benefit from increasing our relaxation, and that's something that music can be a part of, but that is also, you know, I'm sure we're going to hear from our other folks that is a piece of what they do as well. It is very, very person driven. You know, the client or the participant it frequently drives it. So very individualized to what that person needs and what they respond to best.
And do we know exactly what it is about music, like what's happening in our brains that might be helpful for various people that you see in your work? Is there, I don't know, just break
sure.
that down
yeah,
a little
I mean,
bit.
Yeah, there's a lot of neurologic research about music therapy, and there, music therapists, you know, work in physical rehab and neurologic rehab. I think in terms of we're thinking about mental health, and really the way I kind of explain, you know, brain 101 in music therapy is, we think about, with music, we're stimulating the whole brain. So in that one act of listening or participating in music, you can stimulate the cognitive center, you can stimulate the emotion center, the receptive, the expressive, the physiologic. So in, you know, just in that one part of our body, the huge part of our body, the one act of participating in music can stimulate all those areas. And then, you know, for a person who's experienced a mental health, either crisis or, you know, if you think about depression, sometimes it's, you know, our brains are kind of sluggish. And so by approaching the brain in a different direction than maybe what we're traditionally doing, I think we're going to hear that from our other panelists. We're all about coming at the brain from a different direction and coming at the problem from a different direction. But sometimes just that act of making music, because we're accessing the information from a different pathway, either we can dig a little deeper or we can go in a little bit different direction than we were able to go with a traditional talk therapy. We definitely are supplementing those things and supplementing, you know, we're not a replacement for all of the traditional therapy and the medication and all of that, but it's just giving the brain that extra boost just through the power of the music. And it can be as simple as a steady beat. I mean, we use a lot of drumming in music therapy, and just that, and the research about just the very base part of our brain, the primal part of our basal ganglia, is stimulated by that steady beat. And so if you're in a room and someone starts clapping, it is almost impossible not to, your brain tells you to start joining in. And that happens no matter, what your mental state is, it is reaching the depths of your brain. So pretty powerful stuff.
Yeah, that's really interesting. So Katie, you're a registered yoga instructor and a neurofeedback practitioner. We're going to come back to neurofeedback in a little bit, but I want to start with yoga. So how are therapeutic yoga and trauma-sensitive yoga different than what folks might already think of when they hear yoga, you know, a class at a yoga studio?
Yeah. So if you think about working with maybe a mental health therapist who also is a registered yoga instructor, you know, if we're working with someone one-on-one, we can really target what it is that they're looking for. And kind of like Meg mentioned, you know, we are working, accessing things through the body. So in a different way. We can really target things. If someone is looking to, you know, maybe they're dealing with anxiety, we can help bring them back down. If they're dealing, you know, maybe with depression or feeling disconnected or numb, we can bring them back up. We're looking at helping people get into this window of tolerance, is a word that we use a lot, which is where we really just feel like ourselves. It's where our behaviors match our morals, values, and goals. So we can target things like that. I think too, certain poses, like I've had clients of mine that certain poses might be triggering for them. And so working with me, we can work slowly on that pose and start introducing it a little bit so that they can do that in a studio class and not feel triggered. The trauma sensitive part too, is that, you know, if you're trained specifically in that, you're going to be using different language. You're going to be giving people options. If you think about trauma specifically, people aren't given choices with that. And so we're providing an environment where we can give people choices and they can choose. Do I want to not move my body at all? Do I want to do this variation of the pose? Do I want to do this one or this one? That's kind of how we might be different. There's another kind of area that it's not what I'm certified in, but there is a yoga therapy, and those people might be working mental health wise. They might be working, injury rehab, things like that as well.
Yeah. More like a physical therapist or something to get flexibility and stuff. So, you know, since you are both a talk therapist and a yoga instructor, are you working with folks to sort of think about or talk about what they're thinking or experiencing as they're doing the different poses? Is that, or is it sort of a separate, not a simultaneous?
It can be that for sure. Like it's like if a pose might be, you know, triggering for somebody, we could certainly do that. You know, a lot of times for me, it's kind of this educational piece of helping people figure out what they need. So I teach them that window of tolerance. I teach them about being hyper-aroused, hypo-aroused, getting them to start going inward, noticing how they're feeling, and then targeting what they need with yoga. So if they're hyper aroused, that means they have a lot of energy in their body, right? Maybe they need to move their body a little bit and then move into some more stillness. Or if they're, you know, hypo aroused, maybe they need a little bit of kind of gentle movement and then something a little more powerful to bring them back into that window of tolerance.
Yeah, I know I asked Meg a similar question, but what do we know about what's going on in the brain in different yoga poses and that brain-body connection?
Yeah, so if you think about, and trauma specifically, because I do a lot of teaching around this, but the amygdala, which is the fear center, right? A lot of people who've been through trauma and especially repeated traumas, maybe throughout their life or a time period, that amygdala is very temperamental. It will go off. Maybe like we're about to have storms, right? It might go off with thunder, like a really loud noise. And it might tell the brain, that part of the brain might tell the rest of the brain, oh my gosh, this is danger. And it starts activating the sympathetic nervous system, which is the fight or flight. And then all of a sudden this person's body has been hijacked by something that actually isn't really threatening, right? And so, yeah, we have that, we can kind of teach the amygdala to not go off all the time. And so that's a big part of what we're doing with yoga.
Yeah, that's interesting. And then tapping into the parasympathetic nervous system, right? Okay.
Yes, correct.
So Tia, could you explain for us what equine assisted therapy is from, you know, a higher foot view, I guess?
Yeah. So kind of an overview, there's so many different facets with equine therapy. There's equine assisted therapy, there's equine learning, there's assisted learning, there's equine psychotherapy, there's also hippotherapy, which will be more familiar to, as far as the physical aspect of it. So there's lots of different facets with it. What we focus on is with crisis and trauma, ours are more equine assisted. So we do not have necessarily a licensed counselor in those sessions with those kids. It would be like a mentor that we use. But as Meg was saying too, you know, we're not trying to replace talk therapy or other therapeutics. We're there to assist and be in an addition to some of those aspects.
So how does the program at Brightside Youth Ranch work?
Yeah, so we work with kids and teens, but the great thing about horses is it can, horses can be used with all sorts of ages. So you can hear that with veterans who've been through some very traumatic experiences, adults, eating disorders of all ages. I mean, there's so many different things that horses can be used for, but we specifically work with kids ages 8 to 18. So when they come, they are partnered with a mentor and a horse when they come, and then we do have a curriculum that we work through. But as the others were already saying, it's very individualized. So we will focus on the needs of that child and their situation and kind of tailor that. And that's the great thing about horses too, because the horses are also this living, breathing animal that kind of adds an interesting component to it. So we can tailor and very individualize those sessions for those kids.
So what are some examples of different kinds of things that might happen in an equine therapy session?
So, you know, some of our kids have dealt with neglect, abuse, foster adoptive situations, anxiety, depression, self-harm, suicidal ideation. So there's lots of different things in there. But the beautiful part about a horse is we can kind of look at them, see what's going on with the horse, and then internalize it. So we can have time to process what we're seeing and what we're dealing with. So one of the exercises that we do in our program is a lot of the things that we do are on the ground with the horse, because that horse is our partner through this journey. And so we have an obstacle course in an arena, and we will have a child or teen lead that horse through the obstacle course with the lead rope that you've seen on movies or TV or whatever. But eventually we will take that lead rope away and help them understand that there are various ways that we can communicate with this very large animal. And so they're going to try to work through this obstacle course with their partner, their equine partner, in a way that doesn't seem to be like the safety net of this lead rope. And how can they work through that? It's problem solving, it's thinking, it's managing emotions, it's developing confidence, empathy. There's so many different things that happen through that process.
I think many of us might be familiar with therapy animals, but we think maybe more immediately of a dog or a cat. Why horses?
Yeah. And I mean, I'm a big animal lover. I think animals in general, whether you've got a dog or a cat, we actually have baby goats at our house right now too. So whatever animal it is can help you develop some coping skills and some empathy in that process. But horses are pretty unique. So they are designed to live in a herd environment. So they are wired for community, which is not unlike us. We are wired for community as well. And so horses, because they live in a herd environment, a group environment, they are incredibly in tune to the emotional and physical well-being of their herd mates. And they also do that with people too. And they give immediate feedback. So if you're dealing with anger or anxiety, depression, they are going to respond in a behavioral way that we can actually see take place right in front of us. And they will also mirror and reflect what's inside. So if a kid is telling me, hey, I'm good, I'm doing well, but then the horse is behaving differently, I might ask some deeper questions and dig a little bit more because that horse is telling me something different than what that child might be saying with their words. So it's pretty neat to see. And just being around horses, it can lower the cortisol levels, lower blood pressure, lower our heart rate. I mean, it's pretty amazing some of the physiological changes that happen as well as the emotional and mental changes that can happen.
Yeah. I guess compared to a dog or a cat, a horse is certainly a lot bigger, particularly since you work with kids and teens. I wonder, how do you get over that initial maybe bump of anxiety someone might experience around a horse, or someone who has never you've been close to a horse, let alone ridden a horse? How are you breaking that barrier?
Yeah, so that it can be intimidating for a lot of people. Some people are very excited and thrilled to be out there around the animals. Some of them are very intimidated. We have horses of various sizes. All of our horses have been, basically, we have gone through a whole situation that they are our little greeters. They're very happy to receive people. We have some outgoing horses that are in your face right when you arrive, and we have some more introverted horses that are a little bit more reserved. So we try to see the energy level and the comfort level of the child or teen as they enter into the property. And then we will slowly introduce them to what we feel like will be the appropriate horse for that interaction initially. If they want to choose a different horse later, if they want to do something different, that's fine. But we will take it slow and kind of move in that direction and help them understand that, yes, it's a big animal, but they actually are more afraid of a lot of things than we often think they are because they're so big. So we can be their confident leader in that process.
I'm glad you mentioned the different personalities. I was on your website and you guys have, you know, little photos with the names of each of the horses. What makes a good therapy horse? Is there a training process? You know, obviously not every dog, every cat, or every animal is a therapy animal. We all are probably familiar with guide dog training, and that's a very rigorous process that, you know, not all dogs can do. So what makes a good therapy horse?
That's a great question. And you are exactly right. So not every animal enjoys the therapy process or even enjoys being around for us younger people. So when we hear about a horse that someone might want to donate or they're looking to get rid of or move on or can't do a previous job or it's in a difficult situation, we will go do an evaluation. I usually take a young person with me and they move differently than adult. They just have a freer spirit, usually a little bit, maybe more bouncy if they're younger. And I take them with me to go look at a horse because I can see almost immediately when we take a student, let's say 9 or 10 years old, that the horse starts to back away from that energy. It's probably just pulling away internally and can't take that and receive that. So we look for that potential to be innate already, that they want to kind of lean into it. All of our horses go, oh, that looks like a fun child. I want to lean into that. And then when we go through that process and evaluate, they will come to the property and then we'll take them through the training of what it looks like to be in our program and ease them into it. Cause that's not always a good fit for them. And we want the horse to be happy in their job. And cause when they're happy, then they're going to give their best to the child or teen too.
Yeah, that's really interesting. So I know you all have mentioned, you know, that you're not designed to be a replacement for talk therapy or maybe medication. Oh, thunder. Ooh, that scared me. Speaking of the amygdala response there. but we have a question in the chat from someone who said they tried talk therapy and didn't like it. Is there a reason that these kinds of therapies coupled with talk therapy might be more effective? Katie, do you want to take that first?
Sure. I mean, I would say first off with therapy in general, it's relational. So, right. Finding the right therapist. So if the guest today that, you know, it might be just kind of looking for another person and seeing if that might be a better fit for you. Sometimes we're looking at just the access point, right? Like someone might not want to talk about these things, you know, if it's traumatic things or if it's, you know, anxiety, depression, or maybe someone has shame, they might not want to start off talking. So if we can start with something like yoga or what the other two ladies are doing, meet them where they are. And then maybe, you know, a relationship starts to form and there's more trust or someone starts to feel some relief, then there might be a space for some talk therapy to see, okay, what do we need to process or what do we need to kind of talk about?
Do you find that they work best together?
I personally do. I mean, I do both. So, and, you know, I add in neurofeedback and I think it's a nice combination. And it's funny too, with what I do, I have some people that don't even, we don't even actually do any movement, any yoga in my office. They come to me because they've already enjoyed yoga, somewhere else, or maybe they're kind of interested in yoga. Also with yoga, there's philosophy. So sometimes if someone's open to that, we might even weave in philosophy with what we're doing, you know, in their healing journey.
Let's jump to talking about neurofeedback. So that's something you also offer. Could you give just sort of a primer there on what that is?
Yeah. So neurofeedback is really working. We're working with the brain and we're working with that self-regulation. So, you know, we have, like I mentioned earlier, with people being hyper-aroused, hypo-aroused, we have this window of tolerance is where we really want to be as humans. We want to be our authentic selves. But people's brains have become dysregulated, maybe genetics, maybe life experiences. You know, with neurofeedback, we kind of say everybody could benefit from brain training. But what we're doing is we're teaching the brain to regulate itself. So with yoga, I'm helping somebody, okay, you might want to do this style of yoga, or let's do this kind of sequence of poses to help regulate you. Whereas neurofeedback is just doing that for you. So I kind of say it's really nice. You don't really have to do anything. And like we were talking about earlier, you just get to come in and watch Netflix. But we're doing an evaluation at the beginning to see what parts of the brain that somebody needs to work on. And then we start with the training. We put sensors on the scalp. We're not putting anything into the brain. Those sensors are reading the electricity in the brain. So if you think about medication works with chemicals in the brain, the brain also has electricity. And we know about this, about neurotransmitters and things like that. So we're working with the electricity and then we're giving the brain an opportunity to see what it's doing. And then it sees what it's doing and then decides, oh, wait, hold on. I need to do something a little different. And so then it starts to train itself to calm down or to help people, you know, sleep better. We work with the amygdala a lot. Might help people, you know, that have panic attacks, headaches, you know, things like that.
So talk to me if I come in for a neurofeedback appointment or brain training appointment, what happens? Like, how does that work?
Yeah, so we would have already done the evaluation. We know what parts of the brain we're going to be starting on and getting to at some point. We have these frequencies and I equate frequencies to like dosage of medication. And when you go into a psychiatrist, they don't always know the exact dosage that you're going to respond to. So they kind of have to test. And we do the same thing. We have this whole range of frequencies. So someone comes in and we give them a couple of minutes at each frequency and we see if they notice anything. And then we see if they notice things after a session. And then they come back and they tell us, and then we can explore some different frequencies, or maybe we found one that does work. And then once we've found that frequency and we've got the kind of placements, they come in and they watch Netflix. And the part that the feedback that they're getting is the screen's going to get big and small, dark and light, and then the volume changes slightly. And all that feedback is from that person's brain back to that person's brain. The brain knows what it means. I don't know what it means. The people that develop this don't know what it means. And then it learns to regulate itself better. So it's really kind of a cool thing. And it, like you were mentioning earlier, or the participant that said that they didn't really like talk therapy. I always say neurofeedback is a great option because you don't have to really do anything.
Yeah. So, and do we know much about the science of what exactly, you know, you mentioned that you don't know exactly what the electric signals mean, but do we know what you're trying to train your brain to do? Is it to make more of a certain kind of wave depending on, you know, what you're hoping to adjust?
We're teaching, you know, and just to make it simple, we're teaching the brain to be more flexible, be more resilient. So if you think about a lot of my clients will say, a stressor happens. Like I had a client one time that anytime she talked to her dad on the phone, it was just dysregulating for her. She would hang up the phone and just be out of commission the rest of the day. Couldn't work, couldn't enjoy herself, enjoy time with her family. After doing neurofeedback, the conversation would still activate some things, but she would, you know, be done with it, hang up, and then rejoin life. So it's like, it's teaching the brain that, okay, it gets a little dysregulated, but then we're going to bring it back into that window of tolerance.
That makes sense. Meg, going back to you. So I know your recent clinical focus has been on young adults with autism, with limited verbal skills and a history of aggression. What have you seen in that work when it comes to music therapy? How does that approach to that group work?
Sure. I mean, I think it really, regardless, I mean, whoever we're working with in music therapy, music is our connecting point, and very individualized. So what I find with, especially my folks, for someone who's nonverbal, and I think the parallel to mental health, there's lots of parallels, but being able to connect through music is a very safe opening. It's a very, because it is something we all have in common. Because, you know, we talk about music being a part of our lives from cradle to grave. So we're hearing music from the before we're born, you know, as soon as we're born, you know, the tendency is to sing and to sing to children and to sing throughout our lives and connect with music. So we have that connecting point, whether you have the words for it or not. So what I find with, you know, specifically with folks with autism who are nonverbal is just that, again, I'm accessing that connection through a different way. The traditional in your face, I say hello, you say hello, is not effective for them, but maybe I hit my drum 2 times and then they hit their drum 2 times. And it can, we can go a whole session without anybody saying a word. It's just that connecting and interacting and creating meaningful interactions through music.
Very cool. Is there, and you know, in general, are there certain types of music that are kind of universally upsetting or universally calming? What do we know about the psychology of that?
Yeah, I mean, you know, there's kind of what you would expect, you know, the things that you think about all the movie soundtracks that you listen to, that's all, you know, very psychology of music kind of based. We think about the big scary sounds when big scary things are happening. So there's kind of those global ways that we hear and respond to music, but then everybody is very different. And so the thing that is a trigger for somebody, and it could be just because of a memory they associate with a particular sound or a particular song. And then just like with any trauma, then that becomes a trigger. And so, and you might not know that going into a session. That's where that personal relationship within the therapeutic environment is so critical, because you develop that level of trust. And then if you happen to introduce something that's upsetting or brings back a memory that is difficult, then you've already established that rapport and you have that base relationship from which to work. Because music is such an important part in so many of our life rituals, weddings, funerals, other, you know, graduations, big life events. Oftentimes there's a song, breakups. You know, how many of us don't have a breakup song? And I don't know your breakup song. And if it happens to be a song I bring to a therapy session, then that can trigger all kinds of things. So having that therapeutic relationship where we've built that trust to be able to work through those things is very important. And using that, whatever that trigger is. I think I answered your question.
You did. Are there certain, I know it is really tricky when we talk about mental health, you know, to lump everybody together, everyone's brain is different, but are there certain folks that you feel like are more likely to, you know, be very well served by music therapy as opposed to maybe the other therapies we're talking about here today, or, you know, the traditional therapies we've talked about?
Yeah.
Are there like good candidates?
I mean, I think, you know, obviously you don't have to be a musician. You don't have to be really have any what you would call, you know, like some people say, well, I can't sing, I can't do, you know, I can't play an instrument, so I couldn't do music therapy. And that's absolutely not true, because we bring the music in whatever form the person wants or needs. You know, obviously some people are more connected to music, and feel a stronger connection, and they would be a better candidate. And I think I wanted to just kind of go back to the idea, you know, I was saying that we're not replacing talk therapy or medication, things like that. And just like Katie was saying, you know, that the conversation sometimes happens, and there's certainly conversation that goes on in a music therapy session. And depending on where you are in your mental health journey, it is possible that a music therapy could be enough, as long as you're not in crisis or in need of, you know, medications to help with chemical balance. If you're at a stable enough level, and you have a relationship with, you know, a music therapist, or, you know, whatever the alternative therapy, it definitely can be enough. It just, you know, we never want to make a claim to be something more than what we can offer.
Yeah. Katie, I wonder, in your case, do you feel, in your experience, I guess, are there certain folks that seem to be better candidates for therapeutic yoga, seem to respond really well, and same for neurofeedback?
If you think about yoga, I mean, for a lot of times I might introduce people. I mean, I think it's gotten so popularized out there, and especially we've had people like Bessel van der Kolk has written The Body Keeps the Score. He created a whole chapter about yoga, and his whole book is about kind of alternative things to help with trauma. So yoga has gotten a big name, and there's a lot of research studies and things like that as a complement for trauma specifically. I think even for mental health, it's gotten really popularized. So I think that, you know, a lot of times I have people who are a little curious about it. And so, you know, we kind of, you know, start introducing it and whatnot. I have some people that really don't know much about it at all, or maybe they have a certain view of it that it has to be, you have to be really flexible, or you have to be able to stand on your head, or, you know, those kinds of things. So I kind of can help debunk that. And a lot of times it's not only just doing maybe yoga with me, or, you know, sending people home with some yoga homework. It might even also be talking about a studio to go to, because another part of the healing journey is to, especially with trauma, is to get people back connected with other people, because trauma can isolate people. So I think, you know, lots of people can be good candidates, and we've gotten the field of yoga has gotten really good recently with making yoga accessible. So you don't have to be this young, fit person to do it. You can, you know, be in a wheelchair, you can, you know, be old, or, you know, anything like that. So it really, a lot of people, you know, are kind of curious and interested in it now. As far as neurofeedback goes, not as many people have heard about it. So a lot of times with people that come to me, I'm introducing it because they just haven't heard of it. It also has a chapter in The Body Keeps the Score. It just hasn't gotten as much, you know, attention. So I'm assessing kind of when I first meet somebody, if dysregulation is the biggest thing that they're coming in with, and that's really kind of taking over, they can't sleep, they have nightmares, their panic attacks every day, those things, I'm really going to encourage someone to kind of go this neurofeedback route. Let's get things calm for you so that you can live your life the way you want to, and you can have relationships, and you're not drug around by your emotions. And then we can weave in talk therapy, you know, while we're doing neurofeedback, or once we do neurofeedback, let's see what the need is. But, you know, for me, it's really, anybody could really benefit from it. I've also, like I mentioned earlier, people who are maybe resistant to therapy, right? Like, oh, I don't want to do talk therapy, I don't want to talk to anybody. Okay, we're not really talking to me. You just come in and we kind of figure out what symptoms you're dealing with, and then we're going to hook you up and you get to watch a show. So it's kind of a fun way to get people into this space, and then they develop this relationship with me, and then maybe they're open to start talking about things.
Right. Yeah. And Tia, what about with equine assisted therapy? Are there, folks you have seen be particularly successful, or have a good experience with it?
Yeah. So for us, we just ask that they want to be here. We don't really have any requirements. You don't have to know anything about horses to come. We don't have to have all this like riding experience. Like I said, we don't even really ride the horses. So we just want them to be willing to participate in the sessions. And we have found that quite a few of our kids who've experienced deep trauma, they've either learned how to get through talk therapy by just giving bare minimum answers, or they're tired of sitting face to face with someone. It gets exhausting at times. Again, not replacing talk therapy. It has its place. It has its wonderful pieces of it too. But this kind of changes things up. So now we're working more shoulder to shoulder. There's oftentimes a horse in between our mentor and a child. And that creates a buffer. And now this animal that you didn't know when you first got here starts to become your friend. And you can whisper secrets into your horse's ear, and they're going to keep them. And the horse is not a judge. They don't care what you're wearing. They don't care what your family might look like. They don't even really care what your shoes are like. So they're going to invest in the relationship with you regardless of what you may look like on the outside. They care about who you are on the inside and helping you get to be that healthier person. And we start our sessions as an individual one-on-one thing, but then we do move to group sessions as a follow-up too, because we agree the same thing. You know, you might have a moment that you need that focused, intentional session with your mentor one-on-one, but that healing's really going to start to happen when you move out of isolation and into community.
And I did see we got a question in the chat. I think Meg and Katie, we were mentioning some parts of the brain there. Meg, do you want to clarify basal ganglia, and then Katie, amygdala?
Yeah, I saw that question. I was like, oh, gracious, I don't have a diagram on me to share my screen. So we think about I should have brushed up on my brain research before I jumped into that, saying that, but, our primal brain is the basal ganglia is right at the brain stem. So early brain development, and then it kind of, mushrooms out from there. It just speaks to, activation there. That's the part of the brain that's affected in Parkinson's disease. And so that, affecting gait and shuffle gait that you see with Parkinson's, that's because of the breakdown in the basal ganglia. So that just very simple motor movement is that piece of it. I don't have a diagram with me, but there's like the receptive area, there's Wernicke's area and Broca's area where that's processing the information, the speech that's coming in your brain. And then you have the emotion centers that are processing sound as it's, the emotional aspect and your emotional response to sound and the physiological.
And Katie, you were mentioning the amygdala, that's something that you work with a lot in trauma-informed yoga.
Yeah. So the amygdala is, like I said, the fear center. You could also call it the smoke detector. So it's the thing that the stimulus is going to come in through your senses. And let's say if we're talking about trauma, it's going to come in through your senses. One direction it's going to go is to the thalamus. And the thalamus is going to say, okay, where do I need to send this information? It sends it in two places, but one area, it's going to send it to the amygdala. The amygdala is going to say, okay, is this danger? Is this a threat or not? If it determines that it is, it's going to go off. And that's when it sends the information to release the stress hormones. And then it also sends it straight to the sympathetic nervous system. So that fight or flight. So you need to run, you need to go, whatever you need to do to get away from this danger. And like I said, with people who've been through trauma, especially repeated traumas, that amygdala is very temperamental. It goes off all the time. And we don't want, someone to be sitting at their home and hear a thunderclap and go straight into sympathetic nervous system, because, it's not what the brain is telling it is. It's not a danger necessarily in that moment.
We also had a question of someone asking if it's better to do these kinds of alternative therapies alone or in a group. I feel like Katie and Tia, you guys touched on that, but Meg, did you have anything you wanted to add about music therapy?
Yeah, I mean, I think that it would kind of very much depend on the situation. There are full-time music therapists there's a full-time music therapist at Hopeway, which is an inpatient psychiatric center. They also have outpatient treatment, and music therapy groups are a part of that process. I think for folks who are seeking and who really benefit from getting feedback from other people, or maybe the social emotional piece is a big part of their struggle with mental health, then being in a group can be a really important process, a part of that. But you know, as with anything, there are some personal things that are just very individualized, and you might respond better individually. There's also a music therapist who works with Queen City Counseling in there. Adolescent program. And again, it's along with the other groups that they're doing. And so those group processes can be really important to treatment. But I don't know that there's one that's better than the other.
Right.
Depends on what the person needs.
True. It's hard when we talk about mental health, because it's a journey, right? There's no, you know, quick fix. But I wonder how long for folks that decide with one of these alternative therapies, how long until you start to see results, or what success looks like? Katie, do you want to take that? I'm sorry.
I've had people before. I was a yoga instructor. I was bringing in yoga instructors to help with some of my clients. And one of my clients said that was the first time in months she had felt some relief. Just the first session, right? Just moving her body and feeling good about herself for, you know, doing something. So it can be, you know, kind of the first session. I had another client that I worked with individually, and then she was also doing some studio classes. But she, one of the things, like, especially with trauma, is people are out of their body. They don't notice things in their body. And an example might be like the hunger sensation, right? They might not notice when they're hungry or when they're full. I've even had clients that, we were working one-on-one and we were doing yoga, and I would say, gosh, I feel something in my leg. Do you notice anything? And for weeks she would say no. And then all of a sudden she was like, yes, I feel something. So she was starting to, you know, her brain was starting to go back in her body and notice things. So sometimes it could be the first session. Sometimes it can be a while. Neurofeedback, people will find relief in the first handful of sessions. They notice things, you know, for us in order to rewire the brain, sometimes it can take a while. We say a minimum of 20 sessions, but you know, some people, if they have a history of childhood trauma, it can take more than that. But it's not to say that they're not going to feel things. It's just the results might not last in between sessions.
Yeah. Tia, what about you?
Yeah. So for us, and again, you know, the different types of equine therapy, you might have different lengths of that, and it can be very individualistic basis, as far as like in a few handful of sessions, you can start to see a massive difference. And then at the end of our series of sessions, you might just be pulling back one layer at a time. So we have an initial set of series that's 8 sessions that's very focused on processing through that pain and that trauma and starting to look at some coping skills, going to reduce that emotional turmoil and try to increase their functioning and just kind of get them a little bit more stable. And then we actually have them take a break to process some of the things that they learn, and then they can return for the additional sessions to follow up with it in a group environment. And then that's a series of 6. So we have kind of a phased approach to it and just want to deal with some things kind of in layers.
And Meg, for music therapy?
Yeah, I think similar to what Katie was saying in terms of, for some folks, there can be that just real, you know, catalyst moment in a session that, you know, where somebody just kind of really gets in touch with maybe some emotions they weren't feeling before, or experiencing something in a different way. And it kind of just really helps them get some clarity. But again, I'm just going to defer to being very individualized in terms of what the treatment goals are. And, you know, and we would create those treatment goals together. And then, you know, there's a constant, you know, as a professional, we're assessing and evaluating and documenting all of our progress. And so we would, in a mental health situation, we would be, that would be a partnership with the person receiving the therapy to make sure that we are staying goal focused and, you know, achieving what we're trying to do.
Okay, great. And then I wanted to ask also, equine assisted therapy, neurofeedback, trauma-informed yoga, music therapy, are these things covered by health insurance? If not, what would you recommend folks do who might not either might not have insurance or might not be able to pay that copay or might not be able to pay out of pocket, not copay?
I'll start. Is that okay? Unfortunately, it is not often covered by traditional health insurance. Now, most music therapists in private practice are certainly willing to make those attempts with the insurance company and communicate. We're trained and can communicate in the language that can work. It really just varies depending on your coverage and the different insurance company. I know some folks who use their HSA, their health savings account, to pay for alternative therapy. And you know, there are a lot of organizations, I'm thinking about NAMI and other, you know, maybe grant providing organizations that might provide some sliding scale or some assistance with costs. I would also just encourage folks to ask questions. You know, people have sliding scale and might know of other sources of ways to pay for things. It's an unfortunate part of our system. That's a whole nother conversation though.
Right. So Tia, does that apply for you as well?
Yeah, so very similar. I mean, there's some facilities that can at least approach the whole idea of insurance if it's a psychotherapy location. We are faith-based, so we don't often, we're not able to handle the insurance part of it, but we try to keep that affordable. So our sessions are $20 each, and we don't ever want finances to be a problem. So we have people who are willing to scholarship full or partial scholarships, sliding scales. Sometimes there's also, if a person's working, sometimes their work will often see that as an opportunity to invest in that family. So there could be some other alternatives in there. We also have a network with about 100 similar ministries to Brightside. So if someone calls and they're not in this area or we can't meet their needs immediately, then we will also refer them to like-minded organizations that can also make it affordable.
And Katie?
Yeah, so because I'm a mental health therapist, I do accept, the only one I'm part of is Blue Cross Blue Shield. So with the we'll cover yoga if someone, you know, I would need them to be my psychotherapy client for that to be covered by the insurance so that we would have their goals and we would have the diagnosis and all of that stuff. But we look at it as a coping skill type of thing. And so it can be part of what insurance covers. You know, as far as if someone's not able to afford sessions with me, I've got yoga studios in Charlotte that I can help point them to. Like I work at Noda Yoga and we're an accessible studio. And so we try to make it accessible financially too. So if someone does have a certain financial situation, they can talk with the owner and they can maybe work out a plan and I can help them find the yoga instructor that would be maybe trained in, you know, trauma sensitivity. As far as neurofeedback goes, sometimes it's covered. It just depends on the people's plans. Some of the insurance companies haven't quite adopted it yet as something that they're going to cover. And so it does make it a little more complicated. And neurofeedback, what we like to say is it's an investment in a lot of things. It's an investment, you know, in time. There's a lot of sessions involved in you know, the financial piece. Another organization I'm a part of is called Brave Step, and they help survivors of sexual trauma. And so one of the things that they do is they can help link survivors to therapists that they have vetted that are specifically trained in these some of these modalities that help with trauma. And they can help people financially with those sessions. They can pay up to a certain amount of sessions. I've also done yoga programs with Brave Step. So if someone's part of the Brave Step community, they can be a part of my yoga program and then it's no cost to them.
I wonder if you could talk a little bit about what maybe some poses or types of yoga people might find helpful just to take away after this session to use in everyday life for different, you know, coping with different situations.
What I like to say about when someone's starting with yoga is try different styles. You know, if you're going to a studio or you're looking for, you know, maybe someone to work with individually, try different people. It's relational. So it's, you got to find the right kind of match for you. But, you know, I think the thing that I didn't know when I first started with yoga, I went to a hot power class long time ago and I did a few sessions and I didn't like it. And I thought, okay, I don't like yoga. I'm not going to do that again. And then I started getting introduced to, years down the line, different styles. So one that I'm specialized in is restorative yoga. And we're not moving from pose to pose to pose. We do about three poses in a class and you're surrounded by props and you're held up and things like that. So, my best advice is to just try some different things. We've got things like restorative that you're not going to have a lot of effort. You're going to have to, you know, do a whole lot. Yin yoga, there might be a little more effort there. There's things like a gentle class might be kind of up from there. You're going to move, but it's not going to be moving really fast and things like that. And then you've got things like flow class. And then you might have like a hot kind of power situation on the far end. But yeah, just try some different things. As far as poses go, you know, I wouldn't say necessarily there's a certain pose to try. I mean, if I did have to say that, I would say that the final resting pose, it's kind of the pose. And that's a big one that I emphasize in my classes, and restorative would do a 20-minute resting pose at the end of class.
And that's when you're on your back with your arms and legs spread out, right?
Yeah, that's one of the options I give. And like I said, I give choices in my class. So I give that as one. And then I give a side lying pose as another final resting pose.
Interesting. Okay. And Meg, what about you for folks that, you know, may not be able to access music therapy in the traditional sense? What are some elements of that that they could take with them and try implementing in their everyday life?
Sure. I think that, you know, everybody, and there's so many ways to access music with choirs, church choirs, community choirs, and then there's affinity group kinds of organizations that have choirs. There's an LGBTQ plus choir, and there's a, you know, men's choruses, women's choruses, things like that. So, I mean, singing is kind of a definite community option. But even a drum circle, a community drum circle, or, you know, something that's pretty easy to find. Not, you know, most times somewhere on North Davidson Street on the weekend, you can find some people in a circle drumming together. And, you know, just accessing that rhythm and that healing quality of what happens from participating in a drum circle or any kind of music making experience. I think, you know, oftentimes we think we get stopped by thinking, well, I'm not good enough, I don't have the training. But so many of those organizations they're just people coming together to do the thing they love to do. And so, you know, the Charlotte Folk Society, there's lots of places where you can go and experience music with other like-minded folks who you might find some connections to. And then that, you know, the music is a very social event. So it becomes a opportunity for healing.
Tia, maybe a little trickier for you. Horse is not exactly the most accessible, certainly not as accessible as music, but what are some strategies maybe from equine therapy that could also be applied?
Sure, absolutely. A lot of people do have pets. So if you have a pet, you can still sit with a pet and just allow that presence to, you know, breathe it in, hold it close, and just slow your breathing. Those grounding exercises of breathing and naming, you know, maybe five things that you can see, four things that you can hear. Some of those grounding exercises are just fantastic. And you can do those without a horse. So if you have an animal that actually just kind of gives you a little piece of comfort, you can do them without an animal. If you happen to be able to drive by someplace that has horses, you see it out in the field or something, pull over and just kind of watch the horses interact with each other. And there's so much that's happening in those herd dynamics with their body language, which that is very reflective of how we can interact with other people too, good and bad. And so that you can start to observe and see that.
Right. Yeah. I think there's a reason that so many folks got into bird watching in the March 2020. So thank you so much to our guests. Thank you to Meg Stanley Johnson, to Katie Overcash, and to Tia Tharp. We really appreciate it. Thank you to everybody who was watching, listening on Zoom or on Facebook Live. And we just want to remind folks, this is a mental health series. So we will be back tomorrow and on Friday. Tomorrow, we'll discuss religion and spirituality as they relate to mental health. You can join us at 5 p.m. You can go to wfae.org/mental health to register for that if you have not already, or you can stream it on Facebook Live. Thank you so much, everyone. Great conversation.
Thank you for having us.